Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Jim Zemlin.
All right, good morning. Good morning. You definitely know you're in Napa when there are over 300 people registered for the event in the 9 a.m. keynote. It's a little sparse. I assume people had a little fun in Napa last night. Did anybody see the hot air balloons this morning over the valley? A few of you did, Jeff did. It is amazing. I hope tomorrow morning, if it's nice, it's worth getting up a little early. They take off just after sunrise and they float over the valley, just kind of down over this area. So it's definitely just a beautiful sight early in a California morning. I am happy to have you all here, though, for those of you who did show up early. We had a great time yesterday. We're also going to have another happy hour today in the Arbor when sessions end. We still have a few slots to organize discussions on the boards outside. It's sort of our unconference format, if you're interested in that. So today, our first speaker is someone who, I love to tell this story, so you're going to have to indulge me here, Gab. When we were working on a cybersecurity initiative recently, we were working with large technology companies and several financial services companies to raise funds and get technical expertise to come and help fix the supply chain issues I talked about yesterday. Some folks from Goldman Sachs had expressed some interest, and I called up Gab to speak with the CTO of Goldman and was wondering if I could get an intro. Gab sends an email. Friday night, 10 p.m. East Coast time, sub 10 minute response. And what I love about that is how seriously the financial services industry is now taking open source. And the leader of the FINOS project, which is part of the Linux Foundation, Gabriele Columbro, is here to talk about that transformation in the financial services industry to taking open source super seriously. Please welcome Gab.
Thank you, Jim. Thanks, everyone, for making it here early. I had to stop myself from drinking too many glasses yesterday night to be here in shape. But thanks for the great introduction. I'd like to share with you today how FINOS, and more broadly, as Jim said, open source is making a huge difference in financial services. We are the FINOS Foundation, Fintech Open Source Foundation. We joined DLF just a little over a year ago. As Jim said, our sort of core support in terms of membership comes from large financial institutions. Our footprint has been originally in capital markets and investment banking, but we're quickly expanding. And so we now are over 54 members strong, now with several open source companies, tech companies. I see a lot of familiar faces who are members of FINOS in here. And more recently, fintech companies, as well as industry consortia. We're seeing a lot of potential in enabling existing consortia in the financial services industry to accelerate their standardization processes through open source, whether it is about financial inclusion, whether it is about compliance, whether it is about, again, standardization of data. So a very diverse community and a very fast-growing one. So we have almost 50 projects in the foundation. I'm not going to be able to go through all of them in the next 10 minutes, but I'm sure you're familiar with the landscape concept. So if you go to landscape.finos.org, you can take a look about at the almost 50 projects, special interest groups, and standard projects that we have in the foundation. But I want to share a couple of flagship projects for you to sort of understand the breadth of the foundation. Jim mentioned Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs is one of our platinum members and one of their main contributors. The Legend project is by far the largest project that we have in the foundation. It is a logical data modeling platform that is used throughout the whole Goldman Sachs and is now being used in the industry to standardize data models that can be used across sell side, buy side, retail banking, and regulators. We'll talk about that a little more. Perspective, over 3,000 starts, open sourced by JP Morgan. It's a WebAssembly a real-time data visualization library. Again, these are like legit, real open source projects. These people have deleted their internal branches. So they are working open first and then consuming internally. And that, you know, if you're familiar with the industry, this is a big step for them. FDC3, our open standard for desktop interoperability. Think about it, about the FIX protocol for the desktop, if you guys are familiar with FIX. And then cloud. Put a pin on that, as we're gonna talk about it later in the deck. We launched FINOS about 3 years ago. I'm not gonna go through the whole history, but I think a couple of important points to call out. For the first couple of years, we saw a growth in terms of support from vendors. Most of contributions were vendor-led, as you would expect. Technology companies more familiar with open source. But it's been with 2020 that we saw a massive uptake in contributions from banks. The five largest contributions to FINOS last year came from Citi, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley, and Deutsche Bank. Again, as much as I would like to take credit for this, the pandemic, in a way, actually accelerated sort of the digital readiness of these banks and, you know, showed them that it was possible to keep running their business in a fully distributed environment, positioning us as open source communities in a really good place to help them in this transition. And then this year, we actually started seeing an even further growth in terms of contributions from banks, to the point that the top eight of our top eight contributors actually come from four different investment banks. Just let it sink in for a second. By the way, this data is from LFX, just in case you want to go look at it on a live dashboard. This is pretty unprecedented. I mean, this is an industry that, of course, has consumed open source for the last decades. Of course has, you know, participated to foundations from a monetary standpoint, but has never been at the forefront of contributing code. Of course, we all know contributions can come in many different ways, but when you're trying to build a new community, code speaks, code matters. And so having banks leading in contribution, it's something that has the potential of really creating a new dynamic in the industry. Of course, it hasn't always been the case. And so I want to share with you a couple of reasons why we think we got here. This is an article from 8 years ago. And when I first started pitching FINOS to these banks, you know, honestly, this Italian guy telling them to open source their software and their intellectual property, you know, was kind of received with a bit of a lukewarm response, let's say. I mean, but this is 8 years ago. Open source was considered a risk. Too much of a risk for a very risk-averse industry. But then, middle of last decade, something started to change. Take a look at this example. This is the same publication at sort of 4 year difference. They're talking about SecDB, one of the key components in Goldman Sachs that was widely recognized as their secret sauce. Just 4 years later, the very same piece of code by the same publication was identified as a liability, as a potential weakness. Reason being, it was built on an internal programming language for which it was almost impossible to find talent for, as compared to many competitors who were actually starting to build on Python and very lively AI ML ecosystems. And so talent was for sure the first sort of spark that helped the conversation, especially at executive level, for them to take open source, not just consumption, but contribution and engagement more seriously. But there are three, I think, more systemic reasons that I've experienced over the last year why this industry is taking this seriously now. One, there simply is not enough money to keep throwing at technology problems as they used to be. As an example, the top 12 investment firms, their revenue, their top level revenue, top line revenue shrank about $39 billion over the last 10 years. It's almost like Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan disappeared completely. Their bottom line, especially after 2008, in terms of regulatory spend, went up 40%, up to 15, 16% of their overall spend. So, shrinking margins. Of course, we are all familiar with, you know, crypto, the fintech movement, the game stonk, more recent movement of retail traders last year. These are massive events who have just redefined what it means to be a financial institution. I can refer as it a democratization, but really it's just making this institution rethink what they do. And finally, all of these institutions, and accelerated with the pandemic, are going through the digital transformation. They, at different levels, they want to be technology companies. And so this is kind of going back to behaving as a technology company. What better audience hopefully agrees with me that open source is a key, strategic pillar to be a modern technology company. So I'm not going to spend too much time on last year, but there are two items that I'd like to share with you as sort of highlights. We had the 16 members, we had the one new project a month, but we also put together a comprehensive State of Open Source in Financial Services report with the support of the fantastic Linux Foundation research team and partners like Wipro, GitHub, and Scott Logic. If you haven't read it yet, take a look. This is going to be a fundamental baseline for us to focus our execution in the future. And secondly, we're focused on engaging the regulators. We think regulators are a fundamental part of success of this movement, and really they have a lot to gain, because through our open RegTech initiative, we certainly think that primarily institutions can mutualize their implementation, the regulatory implementation. It's common requirements, is a massive item in the bottom line, it's non-competitive, all the ingredients that open source can help sort of reduce cost for. But in the long run, we think regulators themselves ought to be part of the process. And why not? Hopefully by the time my grandkids grow up, write machine-readable regulation in the open. We'd love to have your feedback and your help in this initiative. And as a first project in this area, I'm happy to announce today that FINOS has been partnering with the Enterprise Data Management Council, and specifically their Cloud Data Management Capability Project that got announced 2 weeks ago, is a comprehensive framework to map financial regulation around that data and cloud deployments into an actual spec that can be implemented. Many of the companies in this room are part of EDMC, so we see a huge potential for partnership there. And, very simply, let's have a look at what that means. Start from financial regulations. The EDM Council will map this into a technical spec, which will be released into Apache 2. And on the FINOS side, we'll have a set of, a test suite that can test against this standard, and infrastructure as code that can actually become an ongoing repository of best practices to automatically stand up cloud services that are compliant with financial regulations. And of course, we'll continue looking for where the industry goes in terms of which other standards we ought to be implementing to ensure that the financial system can move their data and workloads in the cloud as safely as we can. We are actively recruiting for these two projects. We think there is a vested interest for technology companies to participate, and so we'd love to hear more from you. Please hit me up. As I go to wrap, just understand that this is, for us, is just the beginning. Just in the last month, we've seen VCs like Andreessen Horowitz put out a strong vision around how open source is going to revolutionize and create the new wave of innovation in fintechs. We've seen regulators in Asia encouraging banks not only to consume, but to participate in open source projects. And as Jim mentioned, three of the several platinum members of the sort of premier members of the OpenSSF are actually financial institutions. Another recognition of how seriously this industry is taking open source, open source security, and honestly, how much they have to lose if they don't do this right. As I said, take a look at our open source in financial services report, because this is an industry that is now on par with others, understanding that open source can drive innovation, and is looking to contribute upstream. So there's a lot of, you know, talent that is untapped within the industry that can help influence and accelerate even upstream open source projects. And so I hope that with this introduction, whether you are a financial institution, whether you are a technology or a fintech vendor, whether you are a regulator or, you know, an individual developer, there is an advantage and there is a value for you to participate in our community. And so, you know, we hope to see you as a first stop next week in New York for our conference. It would be a great way to get your feet wet with our community. And with that, thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you, Jim.
Thanks, Gab. I mean, this is a great testimony to sort of the federation of the different Linux Foundation projects that we have. You know, in fintech alone, you see the great work that Gab's doing. In our Hyperledger project, Daniela Barbosa, who leads that effort, has been working on central bank digital currency initiatives around the world, which are at the very, very, very earliest stages of being discussed, but could have an outsized impact on the financial services industry itself. Another important effort that we have at the Linux Foundation is the Open Voice Network. This is a project that we started that joined the Linux Foundation this year. And this is a project that is looking to create the future of AI voice that's standard-based, interoperable, accessible, and data protected. Why is that important? Well, let's ask Siri or Alexa or OK so-and-so to discuss this today is the lead of the Open Voice Network, John Stein. Please welcome John to the stage.
Hi, I'm John Stein, Executive Director, Open Voice Network. And as Jim suggested, one of the things that we often assume when the topic is voice assistance is, well, we'll ask Siri, we'll ask Alexa, ask Google. Think about that. Think about those assumptions, because those are the assumptions that the Open Voice Network is addressing. Those are the assumptions that threaten for enterprises worldwide, that threaten data, that threaten economic growth, because we are talking about the interface of the future. This little conversation here for 10 minutes is really directed at everybody, of course, but at three different groups. If you or your company is working in artificial intelligence, you're going to be touching natural language processing, natural language generation. If you're working in AI cloud, this is a critical conversation for you. If you're working in IoT or smart environments, this conversation is important to you. And if you are certainly right now working on a QWERTY keyboard in front of you, a few of you are, this conversation is important to you. Because I want you to think about, for the past 20 years, we've had all kinds of great digital developments and interfaces. We've had mouses, we've had touch, we've had tap, we had this, and yet we are still living with, as I see many of you typing, or you're in the prayer position, we're dealing with a 19th century technology that operates really no faster than I was pounding on a Smith Corona back in the day, writing undergraduate papers. What's the Open Voice Network? We're three or four things. We are, of course, an open source community, the Linux Foundation, and proudly so, generated out of conversations that started at MIT. I'm former Intel, former Cisco, Intel, MIT, Capgemini Consulting at a table in a coffee shop in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And we said, what's going to be the next shaping, behavior-changing technology? Voice. voice technology. So that's what we are. We're also a group dedicated to developing standards, as Jim said, interoperability between platforms, agent-to-agent interoperability. This morning at 7 o'clock, a wonderful, yet another great work group phone call working on one of our projects. We think we saw the code being cracked this morning at about 7:15 a.m. How do we have Alexa talk to Google, talk to Siri, talk to Magenta, talk to Raza, talk to Mycroft, sharing data, dialogue, context, controls, giving you as enterprises the opportunity to build it once and use it many, giving you as the enterprise, and here's the critical point, the opportunity to control your data. How many of you ever read a voice technology privacy document from one of the big platforms? Ah. This is the standard ratio of those who know where the data is going. I was in Budapest about 3 weeks ago and asked a whole room full of consumer electronics retailers worldwide. They sell this stuff. They use this stuff. How many of you know where your data goes when you use voice?
Really?
Interoperability, privacy, a DNS for voice, projects working right now. But ultimately, we're also, a third definition of the Open Voice Network is one that I think is for the enterprise community and for all of us. And I've touched on it here briefly. It's about making voice worthy of user trust. User trust, that's not just privacy. That is marketing people and senior decision makers having trust that voice technology is safe, protects data, and can be used to create overall business value. It's individuals in nursing homes who will be using voice for remote patient care. It's in my interest, not somebody else's. Making voice worthy of user trust. Because as we talk about voice, what we need to understand, this is the interface not only technologically of tomorrow, really of today, but it is the interface that is being driven by a consumer behavior revolution. This is the current data from the States. We also have this data. We're investing in primary research. Current data from the States, who's using it and how often? Now, 97% aware of it. Lots of jokes about Alexa and Siri, of course. But it's known. But what's important are the percentage of active users on a weekly basis. The voice industry used to equate active uses once a month. This is multiple times a week. This is also, you know, you see the percentage there for daily use. You also see what they're doing, searching for products and services, searching for information. This is a daily interface tool. And it is also not a tool limited to smart speakers. What is the number one voice device? Ask yourself. Smart speakers? No, that ranks number four in the States. Smartphones, automobiles, smart homes. All of you work in IoT, Cisco, Intel, all you big IoT firms. This is the interface, or as the European Union would say, taking a look at the proprietary platforms in front of it, it happens to be the gateway or the gauntlet for value in IoT. We should be talking. This is the future. This is where it's going, and in operations and for data use. Your salespeople driving back from an appointment. Oh, I'm too busy to enter the data into Salesforce. I'm just far too busy. Far too busy. Speak it. Talk it. Tell us while you're driving home with high accuracy, with multiple languages, and speed that's 3x of typing. put your QWERTY away. Leave the QWERTY kingdom. It's time. This is what voice can do for the enterprise users, very quickly. Most of us think of just that on the left. Oh, well, I can talk to it. It's cute. You know, it plays music for me at home. It's 3x faster than typing. Think of, when you talk about efficiency, think of voice. It's hands-free. You're in the surgical suite. Hygienic. You're in the warehouse. It's hands-free. It lets you listen. This is the single richest data source out there. What I say, how I say it, sentiment and tonal analysis, who I am is saying it, a biometric, and then a multiple biomarker. Listen to me long enough, you can tell if I have COVID. I don't need the temperature gauge. We could just simply cough into our smartphones and we could tell. Schizophrenia, Parkinson's, all being early diagnosed through voice analysis. And then inference can be taken, both good and bad, can suggest gender, ethnicity, location, educational levels. Voice lets you listen. And finally, voice is the door to IoT. Smart systems will be and are now being operated by IoT. The smart home is being operated by voice. And the recent European Union paper spoke to, and I'll say it again, the gauntlet, the gateway, the locked door that proprietary platforms create, and especially create, if you will, taking away the data. We know the value of data. We know it's the lifeblood of decision making. It's the lifeblood of economic growth and opportunity. Being sucked away in your smart environments. As I said, if you're working in AI, if you're working in IoT, if you're working in enterprise value and ERP, we should be talking. Voice is what is going to be the entry point interface for your customers, your clients, your employees. Voice is where it's going. Final slide. This is what we're doing. On the left is the current state. Proprietary platform empires of data. If you run any data through those platforms, they claim it. It's theirs. Speaking to major enterprises, US and Europe, but Australia, the response generally is, I'll be damned, but I didn't know that. What we're working for is what the Linux Foundation stands for and why we're so proud to be affiliated with the Linux Foundation. Open standards-based opportunity, data protected, both individual and commercial, agent-to-agent interoperability, not the interoperability proclaimed by one of the platforms, it's different, and finally, a DNS for voice. I'm John Stein, the Open Voice Network. Jim, thank you. I'm out of time. Appreciate it. Please talk to me.
Thank you. John, I love this project. As some of you know, I went to school in Tokyo and I took some linguistics courses and remember taking a class studying the tendency of short vowels to become long vowels in conversational Japanese. And I never thought I would see the day where voice would become so sophisticated in technology. Just, you know, back then it was the stone ages of understanding voice patterns, and certainly machine learning and AI technology have just completely revolutionized it. This is an amazing project. We're just happy to have it a part of the Linux Foundation. So our next speaker
is going to be here virtually. We're talking about the future of voice. And our next speaker is going to be talking about a future technology that if you aren't all aware of it right now, you should be aware of it. How many people here have been following WebAssembly? All right, so good. This is a pretty forward-looking crowd. So our next speaker, Colin Eberhardt, is going to join us to talk today about WebAssembly. He works for a company called Scott Logic. I think you may have heard Gab refer to Scott Logic a little bit in his talk. This is a firm that is in the financial services industry. And he's going to talk about what's going on in WebAssembly and the future of that technology. So please welcome virtually Colin Eberhardt.
Hi, my name's Colin Eberhardt, and I'm the CTO of Scott Logic, a UK-based software consultancy. I'm so sorry I cannot be there in person with you all. I don't think I need to explain why. Today, I'm going to be talking to you all about WebAssembly. Now first, a bit about myself. I'm a complete WebAssembly geek. I've written a book about it, I run a popular newsletter, I contribute to Assembly Script, a leading WebAssembly language, and various other open source projects. I've also delivered a lot of talks on WebAssembly and done many fun things. For example, here on the slide you can see an augmented reality Sudoku solver that I wrote using TensorFlow and other WebAssembly technologies. Now today, I'm going to be talking to you in excited tones around a number of different topics and answering a whole bunch of questions. For example, why do we need WebAssembly? What is WebAssembly? Who's using it and what are they using it for? I honestly could talk for hours on this, but time is limited. At the very least, I hope I impart some of my enthusiasm for this topic onto you all. So firstly, let's start at the beginning. Why do we need WebAssembly? For me, in very simple terms, it's because JavaScript just isn't good enough anymore. JavaScript was originally conceived as a simple scripting language. It was invented 25 years ago, and at that time it added just a little bit of interactivity into an otherwise very much static web. A couple of things have changed in the meantime. Well, a lot has changed, but I can sum it up as a couple of simple things. Firstly, we write lots of JavaScript. I've been involved in projects where the front-end code is more than 100,000 lines of JavaScript. Secondly, the way that we deliver our JavaScript to the web has changed significantly. Our tool chains are highly sophisticated. Most of us treat JavaScript as a compilation target these days. I personally use TypeScript quite a lot, and that's compiled to JavaScript. It's then minified, tree shaking. Basically, it goes through a number of really complex transformations before it reaches the browser. That's okay, isn't it? That's good. Well, actually, it's not okay, and it's not that good, because it was never really designed to do that in the first place. And to understand why that's a problem, you need to understand a little bit more about the journey of your JavaScript code to the point of execution. So this is a very sort of simplified view. Your JavaScript code is downloaded over HTTP as a stream of characters, which are parsed into an abstract syntax tree. From there, typically, your browser will generate a bytecode and will immediately run it in an interpreter. Now, in order to make JavaScript fast, and JavaScript actually is really quite fast these days, your browser needs to perform a number of optimizations. It needs to spot ways that it can execute your JavaScript faster by making a number of assumptions. Now, Safari, for example, has multiple tiers, I think four different tiers of execution. However, if some of the assumptions it makes around your code become invalid at a point in time, it needs to descend, it needs to bail from a more highly optimized tier down to a slightly less optimized tier. Basically, my take-home message here is JavaScript is very fast, but eventually, there is a time impact to this. So whilst your tool chain is really quite advanced, your TypeScript code is compiled, the way that it's fundamentally delivered to the browser hasn't changed all that much. And this has an end user impact. If we turn this into a timeline and look at what the end user experience is, first, your JavaScript is parsed, then it's compiled, optimized, it might be re-optimized and then it's executed, and yes, there is a garbage collector. Your browser has to do a lot of work to execute the code that you've written. Interestingly, and there's a fantastic quote from the joint paper that the founders of WebAssembly put together. The web has become the most ubiquitous application platform ever, and yet by historical accident, the only natively supported programming language for that platform is JavaScript. Now, don't get the misconception that this is written by a bunch of JavaScript haters. These are people that love the web platform. But I think it's safe to say that we're using JavaScript in a way that it was never designed to do so. So now is a good time to introduce WebAssembly. Now, a simple one-liner explanation of WebAssembly is it's a new portable size and load time efficient format suitable for compilation to the web. So in a single sentence, it's telling us that it's tackling these issues head on. And again, using this timeline, if we compare JavaScript at the top to a simplified view of WebAssembly at the bottom, when WebAssembly modules are delivered to the browser, firstly, they are decoded, no need to parse them, they're in a binary format. They're still compiled and optimized, but it's very rapid, and the path to execution is very, very short. Fast decoding happens across multiple threads. Basically, it's designed to be fast. A great quote from Yehuda Katz here. JavaScript code is much more expensive byte by byte than an image because of the time spent parsing and compiling it. With WebAssembly, it's possible to compile and parse and compile as fast as it comes over the network, which makes it much more like an image than JavaScript code. Game changer. I think that's a fantastic quote. Finally, one of the things I want to point out is that last year WebAssembly was added to W3C alongside JavaScript, HTML and CSS. It's hard to understate how significant this is. WebAssembly is the first new language that's been adopted by the web platform in 25 years. Whilst obviously people will know about Flash, Flex, Silverlight, none of them were official languages of the web. They were let in effectively through the back door and the plugin model. WebAssembly is the second language of the web, second to JavaScript. So what is WebAssembly? I've done a kind of hand-wavy, this is how significant it is, but personally, I like to get my hands dirty. I like to roll up my sleeves, take a look under the covers, and really look at what a technology is. I want to share a little bit of that with you today. So let's have a look at a real WebAssembly module in action. So this is a very simplified example. I've got a C function here, which takes a number and raises it to a power using a very simple iterative approach. Nothing terribly advanced. I'm using the mscript and compiler here, a simple command line compiler, to compile that C code into a WebAssembly module. And here you can see I'm outputting to the terminal what the WebAssembly module looks like. So rather than JavaScript, which is delivered as text, WebAssembly is a compact and tight binary format. Now, typically, you don't look at WebAssembly in its binary form. You look at it in this form, which is WebAssembly text format. It's more readable, and here you can see some of the parallels with assembly language. It has a very assembly-like feel to it. I know there are concepts here, for example, you've got if statements and constructs you don't typically find in assembly language, but it has that kind of low-level feel to it. Now, how do you execute WebAssembly? At the moment, you cannot just load a WebAssembly module directly into the browser and execute it. You have to load it via its host environment, which is in this case JavaScript. In this example, I'm actually using Node because it takes a few, fewer lines of code required. So what's happening here is I'm reading the binary file into a buffer. I'm using that to instantiate a WebAssembly module using the new WebAssembly API. I construct an instance of the module and then simply execute the exported function. So here you can see I'm executing my power function, which we saw in the previous slide. So if I execute this within Node, funnily enough, the answer is 2 to the power 3 is 8. So here we are executing native code, and we can do exactly the same thing regardless of whether that code's C++, Rust, Go, assembly script. So a few quick facts about WebAssembly. It's a stack-based machine. It has just 4 numeric types and 67 instructions. Again, it feels like a sort of assembly language and a very simple virtual machine. It's designed to support streaming compilations. What that means is it's designed for environments where the code is delivered over HTTP or some other network stream. It has very simple and fast validation rules. It has no built-in I/O, so you will have seen in our previous example, to output to the console, to actually interact with the environment, it needs to work with its host. You can do this via function imports and exports. Also, you can share the WebAssembly memory with the host environment. So who's using it and why are they using it? Now, I haven't got time to tell you about all the applications of WebAssembly, so I'm going to quickly rush through a few that I think are the most interesting and notable. The first one I want to talk about is PSPDFKit, because they were very much an early adopter. PDF rendering is complicated. Typically, you'll need a code base of maybe 1 million lines of code to effectively do justice to PDF rendering. Through WebAssembly, the team behind this were able to take their existing C++ code base that's typically executed on the desktop or the server and execute it within the browser, and they were actually able to add that as a first-class product. On a similar vein, AutoCAD, they were part of the Google I/O keynote on WebAssembly. They have a 30-year-old code base, and previously they've attempted to port it to JavaScript or Flash, but firstly it's been too costly to recreate this 30-year-old massive code base. Secondly, they didn't really have a desire to support two quite separate code bases for effectively the same product. Now, through WebAssembly, their core rendering engine can work on the desktop and work in the browser through WebAssembly. Another example, Google Earth now runs within the browser, similar to AutoCAD. It means that I can open up my browser and have a look at Silverado Resort and shed a tear that I cannot be there with you today, but I can at least fly around it in a virtual environment. Less about that. Microsoft Blazor, Microsoft's latest UI framework that uses C# and the .NET framework, runs on WebAssembly. You can execute C# and .NET within the browser, and you'll find typically line of business applications now starting to use Blazor. Final example, because it's most current, just last week Adobe announced Photoshop for the web. And again, similar story. They have a huge C++ code base, and through using some really cutting edge and new WASM features, for example, threading and SIMD, which allows for faster execution, they're now able to bring their products to the web. One thing I do want to point out here is I've focused on some of the really big examples, some really big products, often with a quite a large historic code base associated with them, now able to move to the web thanks to WebAssembly. There are a number of teams that are using it for the little things. So, for example, eBay have been exploring using WebAssembly for a QR code reader. 1Password are using it for various different components of their product. So it's not just about porting large C++ code bases. You can use little elements of it here and there. So it's fair to say that WebAssembly is a significant success on the web. So that brings me on to the next question. Why did WebAssembly escape the browser? This is something that I think some people found a little unexpected, but I think we should look back on history. JavaScript escaped the browser through Node. It's not too surprising that WebAssembly has broken free too. And again, I cannot really give this do full justice to this. I'm going to be a bit hand-wavy here. But the WebAssembly runtime is simple, it's lightweight, it's portable, it's highly secure, it's effectively sandboxed through the fact that it has no built-in I/O. It's language agnostic. You can write Rust, Go, assembly script, C# code, and it will run within WebAssembly. Importantly, it's also host agnostic. So whilst you can run WebAssembly within the browser through the JavaScript host, WebAssembly was never designed to be tightly coupled to the browser. It has a simple host interface, and that host can be anything you like. Interestingly, I ran a State of WebAssembly survey about 3 or 4 months ago, and one of the things I asked people is about the future impact. where do you think WebAssembly will have the most impact in the future? And you'll see on this chart that the big sort of dark red sections are where people think there will be a high impact, and the orange is some impact, and it's ordered by the level of impact. Around about 75% of people feel that it will have a very high impact on the web. Not far behind, serverless at around about 60%. Games, containerization, audio visual, people feel, have a strong sense that WebAssembly will have a high impact in a number of fields. Interestingly, blockchain is the one with the biggest don't know shrug, don't know what the impact will be, which is not too surprising. I want to talk about just a few of the outer browser use cases. And one example I want to talk about is its use within serverless. So Fastly are a company that I've used their serverless offering using WebAssembly. I think it's fantastic. One of the challenges that people have within serverless is, whilst conceptually it feels simple and lightweight, you're just sending a few lines of code to the cloud and you're executing it without having to worry about the infrastructure that executes your code. Conceptually, it's simple. However, in reality, it's really quite complicated. Your code is being run on a fairly complicated stack of virtualization, and that comes at a cost. Anyone who's used cloud functions, Lambda functions, will know of the challenge of cold start times. Basically, the time it takes to spin up the infrastructure required to execute your little piece of code. Fastly and Cloudflare and other typically edge computing providers have latched onto the lightweight nature of the WebAssembly runtime, the fact that it's language agnostic, and they are building out cloud computing functionality where WebAssembly is the runtime rather than the more costly virtual machines. A great quote here from Fastly: "We built our own WebAssembly-based compiler and runtime for their computer edge platform. Startup times are 100 times faster than other offerings in the market. It's highly significant. The advantages of using WebAssembly here are really crystal clear, in my opinion." And it's not just serverless. Fastly and Cloudflare are leading the charge in that area, but there are other providers too. Containerization, WebAssembly is having a big impact there. Probably the biggest news is that Kubernetes now has first-class support for WASM via Crosslet. And just a couple of weeks ago, Microsoft announced support for WebAssembly running on Azure Kubernetes Service, or AKS. So it now has support via Azure. Blockchain. I know that a number of people shrugged their shoulders and said, "I'm really not sure what the impact will be." I'm confident personally that the impact will be significant. Some of the new blockchain technologies, from Near Protocol, Polkadot, the Internet Computer, where their main focus is to allow the execution of distributed applications rather than just a distributed network of currency. Almost all of them are selecting WebAssembly as their runtime. Also, plugin hosts. If you want to offer a mechanism for third parties to execute their own applications and services within your application, WebAssembly, because of the secure containerized nature of it, is an excellent choice as a plugin host. Much more. I've only scratched the surface, and I know in this conference you'll hear more from some of the CNCF members about some of what they're developing. One thing that I must talk about, though, is, or at least reference, is WebAssembly system interface. As many people are trying to execute WebAssembly outside of the browser, they're having to create their own interfaces for how they execute the I/O capabilities of their environment. So WASI, or WebAssembly system interface, is plugging this gap. It's bringing the community together to agree standards for things like file system access or network. It's effectively ensuring that people don't have to reinvent the wheel. And to throw in another quote, this is from one of the co-founders of Docker. He said that if WASM and WASI existed in 2008, we wouldn't have needed to create Docker. That's how important it is. WebAssembly on the server is the future of computing. That's a pretty bold claim, but a bold claim from someone who really knows their stuff. So finally, as my talk comes to a close, I want to end on: what is the future of WebAssembly? Now, if you recall earlier, I shared a quote that JavaScript has become ubiquitous somewhat through historical accident. I want to finish with a quote from the future. It's a quote from myself, and it's what I will say when Linux Foundation invite me back to the summit in 2022. The pandemic is over and I can attend in person, and this is what I'm going to say. WebAssembly has become the most ubiquitous application runtime ever through supporting a diverse range of languages and programming paradigms within a secure, lightweight, and portable runtime. So, thank you to everyone. Enjoy the conference. I really hope I've piqued your interest and you are as excited about WebAssembly as I am. Have a great day. Thank you very much.
I'll tell you, one of the best parts about this job is being able to see these future technologies pretty early. I remember having a dinner in London several years ago with Colin. He had just written a book on WebAssembly, and we talked about it, and it was just so obvious that this was going to be big. And I look forward to seeing his prediction and whether or not it comes true next year. For more information, or if you really want to take a deep dive into WebAssembly, the Linux Foundation does have a completely free introduction to WebAssembly course online. I don't think it's too long; it's 4 or 5 hours. But if you're up for the next level of detail on WebAssembly, go check that out. Again, it's completely free. Our next speaker is someone who I talked into coming to work at the Linux Foundation on an emerging project in open hardware. Calista Redmond had been at IBM working on open power, also a whole bunch of different open source initiatives in networking, open daylight, and others. I may have understated the task at hand when she joined, but Calista has more than met the moment. RISC-V is now one of the fastest growing silicon architectures out there. She has done an amazing job, and that community is incredibly vibrant. She's here to tell you about it today. Please welcome Calista Redmond.
Kind of funny, I got something different on this screen than I have on this screen, but I'm going to go ahead and assume that we are on track. So thank you so much for having me here today. I have never been more excited about a momentous time in computing history than when I joined RISC-V. So this has been an incredible time for us. If you think back, the last time that microprocessors really kind of engaged our attention was kind of the mid-80s, when there were the processor wars. And I'm going to take you back even a little bit further and assert that hardware was the OG, original gangster, of collaboration, right? So if you dial back about 100 years to the UK when standards organizations first began, that is when we really saw the power of collaboration and building from a common framework, a common foundation for the benefit of many. Let's get rid of the difficult, yet mundane, yet we all need it stuff at the bottom. And let's build from there. Let's collaborate from there. And now we've seen a renaissance in that collaboration, that activity that has gone from open standards into open source, and really all around us is open collaboration. As Jim talked about in his keynote yesterday, collaboration is really what pulls us through, what progresses us the fastest. It's not a small tweak of the dial, it is a giant leap forward. In our situation, you know, whether it's coming together as a community, as a nation, as a globe, as a world community around COVID and tackling that challenge, or tackling the great opportunity and the positive impacts of open collaboration in open source software, that is now very true for hardware as well. So open source collaboration, whether the result is open source software or an open standard or an extension for an ISA, this is now common. These are the building blocks that are absolutely vital and crucial to strategies and technology. So RISC-V is the most ubiquitous open source instruction set architecture the world has ever seen. It was born in the 80s, along with many other architectures, and has transpired through time and cultivated itself. And we are now on version 5. And by the way, this is it. There's no version 6. Spoiler alert. And it has enabled a real renaissance in collaboration, a real renaissance in design. It allows for the open collaboration on many different extensions. And I'll talk just a little bit about why that's so important for us. But RISC-V is that instruction set architecture. Think of it as the blueprint. Two big reasons why it's so important. First of all, it's technology. And second, it's going to be business. But let's talk about the technology. It is very modular. Unlike other architectures, you're not beholden to 1,500 base instructions. You get 47. 47 base instructions. And upon that, you can add the extensions that matter for your implementation. That creates opportunity. It creates design flexibility. Rather than getting the entire enchilada, you can order a la carte, right? And you can order what you need for your design and have that flexibility. You don't have to spend 2 to 3 years negotiating a license for a black box and you get everything in it. You can take what you need, collaborate on additional extensions that everyone in your industry or your particular space need, and you can go from there. That design flexibility, that modular design, and that transparency equals security are what are fundamentally changing the approach that many are taking in designing microprocessors very specific to the needs that they have. All right, I was at IBM for a long time. And you do not get to go to the boss and say, hey, I've got a really cool new toy, and it's going to change the world. That's not the argument you make. You say, I'm going to save money. I'm going to lower risk profile. I'm going to capture new opportunity. I'm going to be competitive in our space while still collaborating with our partners. I'm going to open the door for collaboration partners to design what goes into the project. I'm going to open doors to opportunities we've never seen before. Those opportunities are huge. The financial side of this is incredible. This is not about techno-nationalism that Jim talked about yesterday. This is about global collaboration. When you open the doors, when you take down those barriers, your collaboration partners increase, your supply chain increases, you get to collaborate with anyone you want to around the world on what goes into your product, and then you can take your product across all of those borders as well. You can tweak your product to go from automotive to wearables to hearables. You can take your product to go from enterprise data servers to cloud servers to HPC and other scale-out implementations. There's tremendous opportunity. In fact, those opportunities are skyrocketing even faster than RISC-V, which is, by the way, on quite a tear. So let's think about that. 50 billion connected in IoT devices by 2030. And by the way, every time they come out with a new version of these reports, the numbers increase. So this is probably way out of date by now. So this skyrocketing opportunity means we're putting microprocessors in corners we never imagined, from enterprise to embedded, from your toothbrush to your toaster. Everything now seems to need a microprocessor. Well, that's transpiring across OEMs as well. Once upon a time, about 30% of OEMs were designing their own microprocessors. Now that's up to 40%. By the way, they've stopped the time clock, so I get to go all day. Just FYI. The RISC-V piece of that opportunity is going through the roof. Right now, they've given us this report. This report came out about a year ago. A year before that, this number that now says 80 billion RISC-V cores by 2025, a year ago they said that was going to be 62 billion. So I can't wait to see what they say this year. because just this week, I know about billions of RISC-V cores that are already in market. And if you look on this chart on where 2021 is, we are on a tear, guys. And this is only increasing. And we're seeing this come out already. So now let's not forget that the total market for microprocessors is continuing to grow. $8.6 billion opportunity is being captured on all of those new workloads with RISC-V, right? Nearly a third of IoT is predicted to be on RISC-V, a third. This is an architecture many of us kind of forgot about since about 1985. Industrial, automotive, across industries and around the world, the advantages of RISC-V in reducing your risk profile, because everyone's investing in it, you're no longer reliant on a single company for your strategy, for your destiny. You're no longer concerned about being blocked by geopolitical concerns, by markets closing, by supply chain disruptions, because you have that freedom. You have design, technical flexibility, and you have business opportunity. This growth is already happening. We're seeing the growth transpire in IP. There are now more design houses on RISC-V than any other architecture in history. I mean, I could just kind of sit here and throw fun facts at you all day long. Guys, RISC-V is what's already happening. This is not the future. This is today. Nearly a quarter of design starts already include RISC-V. Nearly a quarter. This is also old information. But we're getting fresh information. So let's talk about industries. It's happening and transpiring across industries. In fact, just about a week ago, we saw Intel. They have RISC-V chip. Alibaba just open sourced four different chips that are RISC-V based. And by the way, they are completely surrounding that with toolkits and other opportunities. Imagination has an entire RISC-V CPU family. Seagate, hard disk controllers, and Western Digital has been a long supporter of ours as well in storage. Telecom and communications, 5G. You know, it's like you drive up and down, you know, the 101 in California, read the billboard, you know, one day it's virtualization, the next day it's cloud, and now it's 5G, right? You always get to see the latest iPhones. Andes got their RISC-V chip at SK Telecom. Alibaba, huge effort and huge lift. They have brought RISC-V to Android. Google sees RISC-V in their Titan M2, specifically around security. The future is already happening. This makes my job like super fun, by the way. Like I get like a new raft of fun facts just about every day. In automotive, huge concerns and criteria around safety and security to meet standards so that you don't run over the cat with your autonomous driving. Imagination Technologies is deeply involved here. IAR Systems, working with Denso's subsidiary on security and their embedded workbench. Renaissance and Sci-Fi taking a leadership role as well in crafting solutions very specific to automotive. In Europe, the GA Next project for charging your automobile, very important areas to improve the systems that they use for electric vehicle chargers. Consumer and IoT, from wearables to hearables. Zepp Health, also known as WAMI, has been using RISC-V in their health watches for years. Huawei has a board that they've put together for the Harmony OS. Rios Lab, as well as Sci-Fi, personal computers. Green Waves, very engaged in hearables. In fact, there are millions of earbuds going out every month with RISC-V in them already today. I'm kind of thinking I need a pair of those. I want the ones with the cat and the light up, the whole thing. I think it would be great. So AI and ML. When I look at the spectrum of companies that are engaging in RISC-V, by the way, they range from venture capital organizations with entire funds directed to RISC-V based companies. Why? Why are VCs so interested in RISC-V? There's no barrier to entry. Anyone can start a company on RISC-V today, and it's happening in spades. We have so many entrepreneurs that are starting their businesses and dedicating their entire company to RISC-V. But in AI and ML, this is an interesting complement to what we're seeing in the data center. If you've got a legacy investment on another architecture, I can speak from experience, it's a real tough climb up that hill to explain to your management chain, you know, thanks for the millions that you've invested in that, I want to switch. But you can make the argument that says, I'd like to augment what we're already doing with AI and ML so we can be more competitive in cloud, so we can be more competitive in automotive, so we can be more competitive in our IoT strategy. And that's what we're seeing. That's what these companies are embarking on. And they're teaming together, whether it's NVIDIA and CUDA. NVIDIA has been shipping RISC-V with their GPUs for years. And by the way, they are still pretty committed to RISC-V. Jensen has publicly stated that he continues to support and is not wavering from his RISC-V strategy. You can do a both end, by the way. You can have a chip with ARM, with RISC-V, you can pack it all on there. We are making things portable, flexible, and easy to work with. And by the way, porting your software to RISC-V, we've got lots of reports and cases from our community that say it's not that hard. Days, maybe a few weeks, and you can be up and running. We have all the major operating systems. We have a great ecosystem. So edge computing, another very hot spot for RISC-V from the various activities that we see going on there as companies pivot and craft and move into adjacent spaces, not just storage, but actually churning and crunching that data. High performance computing. You know, high performance computing, I mean, so they were sort of the original crew when it came to some of the AI and ML. Like, how can I glean insight from massive amounts of data? Europe has really taken a leadership role here, working with, Barcelona Supercomputing Center to the European Union and others are investing heavily in HPC. And you see some of that resulting in our community as well. It does take an entire community. We are incredibly proud to team up with stakeholders from across our community, whether they are in the services, in the fab, in the IO space, in the software space, from chips and IP to fabs, across industries. We are engaging and building alliances around the table. This also ranges from individual contributors and engineers and students and researchers to investors, to universities and other stakeholders, analysts and press included. So this chart looks a lot like the other charts that I showed you. We are growing very rapidly. We now have more than 2,300 members in RISC-V across 70 different countries with a great diversity across various parts of the industry and ecosystem. We have about a third of our members in North America, a third in Europe, and another third in APAC. But we're growing really fast. In 2020, we grew 133%. So yeah, we more than doubled. In 2021, we more than doubled in the first 6 months of the year. So what do we do as a community? RISC-V International, our number one mission is making our members successful. This is not a hobby. This is not an after-school activity. This is all about making commercial success, changing the game, and disrupting the status quo for semiconductors. So we, number one in that mission, produce technical deliverables. We have more than 60 different work groups working on extensions, toolkits, industry-specific profiles and platforms to serve that need. We offer compatibility. We look at compatibility suites. This is not verification, compatibility to particular profiles and platforms that help our community work together and collaborate with assurance. We work on visibility. We want to make all of this success wildly visible to the entire community because the more folks are aware of what's going on, the more engagement we see. Learning and talent, seeding the entire industry with qualified talent through online learning, engagement with universities, shared curriculum, labs, tests, resources for university professors. RISC-V is now taught in almost all major technical universities. Advocacy and alliances, we have meetup groups and ambassadors spread around the world, leading very important talks and engagement engineer to engineer, and a marketplace exchange where we are showcasing as much of our community as possible. So we have a lot to do, and we have a lot underway. We have about 16 extensions up for ratification now. This means that our community is rolling up their sleeves, hands on code, and influencing the direction of the next era of computing, which is fundamentally important across all of these spectrums. So we have a lot to do. We have a lot that we're working on, whether it is extensions and things that are a good fit across multiple different industries or industry-specific work groups like automotive, like Android, like HPC. So we team up with and grow alliances across the entire ecosystem with many different Linux Foundation projects and with others across the industry, whether they are operating systems in the data center or in embedded operating systems there, or test suites, or other architectures, implementation groups, and security. So I encourage you, if you have not taken a great look at RISC-V already, think about how that deeper engagement on the hardware side can influence your strategy. Think about how you can build RISC-V and open hardware into your personal passion, your personal mission, along as an individual, as a company, or as part of the mission that you're engaged in the open source efforts you're already on. So thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you, Jim. And thank you all for joining us.
There you go. Thank you. I think you're starting to see a pattern emerge here. Linux, Kubernetes, RISC-V. You know, the work that we do at the foundation is so gratifying in that we're making markets. You know, technologies you might not have heard of before, you know, WASM and so forth, become massive market moving things. And it takes a huge amount of coordination to do that. And Calista has just been doing an amazing job in that context. But you know, you've also seen, you know, a voice, all these different advanced technologies. And one of the things that I think is really important is technology in and of itself is nothing without context, without the context of how it's being applied to make all of our lives better as human beings. And our next speaker is a best-selling author. He was the author of The Most Human Human, which is a best-selling New York Times book. He also was the co-author of Algorithms to Live By, but in his latest book, The Alignment Problem, Machine Learning and Human Values, he really looks at humanity's blind spots and tries to answer the questions about how technology impacts our collective values. So please welcome the author of The Alignment Problem, Brian Christian.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Perfect. Well, it's a real pleasure to be with you this morning, and I would like to talk specifically about machine learning. Because I think we find ourselves at a very critical juncture around the development and deployment of ML systems in the real world. And I think there is an important role for the open source community to play in what the path forward looks like. So, as I'm sure we are all aware, we have just come out of what I think is an incredibly transformative decade for machine learning. And just to give one example, we have seen an image classification error rates dropping by something like 90% in 6 to 7 years. Fast forward to the present, and it has now gotten to the point where you can't even take a photograph with a modern iPhone or Pixel without invoking, in this case, an 11-stage ML pipeline that's doing everything from the white balancing to noise reduction to compositing multiple different focal planes together. And I want to reflect on this because I think this example, as quotidian and everyday as it is, really shows us something about the relationship that we're coming to have with ML. in ways that are often invisible, it is increasingly mediating our experience of not only the digital world, but also the physical world. Of course, we are seeing with the development of autonomous driving, cars that are increasingly on our streets and on our highways, and whether you are yourself at the wheel or you are driving behind one on the 101 or you're crossing the street in front of one in San Francisco, your physical safety is now tied up in the question of, are these models seeing what we think they're seeing? And Andre Karpathy at Tesla has described machine learning as essentially eating away all of the handwritten C++ code in their software stack. We've also seen this in ways that I think are subtler and not quite as celebrated, namely the use of ML and statistical methods in the criminal justice system. And we are currently going through an exponential uptick in the use of ML at virtually every stage within the US criminal justice system. And so what we're seeing here is that machine learning is replacing both human expertise, human judgment, and software of the traditional sort of handwritten, explicit, logical kind. And it's doing so in both our most everyday interactions and in cases that have the potential to shape our entire life. So there are a lot of reasons, frankly, to be concerned. Are these systems actually learning what we think they're learning? And ultimately, are they going to behave in the way that we think they're going to behave? This is a set of questions that has at least 60-year history, going back to a seminal essay from the MIT cybernetics pioneer Norbert Wiener, who wrote in the days when machine learning was barely starting to play checkers about these sort of longer-term concerns that he had. And he made the analogy to The Sorcerer's Apprentice, which many of us know as the lovable Disney cartoon from Fantasia, where we have the amateur magician enchanting this inanimate object and giving it some instructions to complete a task, only to discover that his instructions were not quite precise enough and catastrophe results. Now, Wiener makes this argument where he says, if we use to achieve our purposes a mechanical agency with whose purpose, with whose operation we cannot interfere once we've set it going, then we had better be quite sure that the purpose that we put into the machine is the thing that we truly desire. And over the last several years, we have seen this move from, I think, a fairly marginal worry in ML to becoming, I think, one of the cornerstones of the field. And we know it today as the alignment problem. So a quick word about myself before we dive in. So my academic background is computer science and philosophy, and I'm part of the computer science community at UC Berkeley, where I'm affiliated with a number of groups there. And I'm also an open source contributor to a number of different projects, nothing as hardcore as instruction sets or OS kernels, unfortunately. But the primary work to which I've committed my career has been as an author. And as Jim said, I've written a series of books for a general audience that look at the ways that computer science impacts us at a human and social level. And I write my books, as it turns out, using LaTeX and Git. And so I could not do the work that I do as an author without open source software. And it has been fun trying to explain to my editors in New York how to open a pull request with changes for one of my drafts. So about 5 years ago, I decided that I wanted to tell the story of the alignment problem, how these questions of human norms and human values in ML have become, I think, very quickly one of the central concerns of the field. And I wanted to paint a sort of portrait of the technical and interdisciplinary community that has come together to do what I think of as some of the most exciting and also some of the most important work in the field. That process took me through archival research into the field's pioneers, going through the correspondence between Walter Pitts and Warren McCulloch in the 1940s, all the way to the present, where I conducted about 100 interviews and oral histories with people that are working in the, you know, across all different parts of the field today. And those are the stories that comprise the book. Obviously, we don't have time to get into all 100 of those stories, but there are a few threads that I wanted to pull through in particular this morning. So, said most plainly, how can an ML system, as Norbert Wiener said, fail to have the purpose that we truly desire put into it? And what, in turn, can we do about that? Okay, so we can basically think of ML systems, painting with broad strokes here, as having two sides. There's the training data, the examples, the environments that we give it to learn from. And then there's an objective function. There's some way that we have of operationalizing what it means to perform well or poorly in each of those examples. So let's look at each of those sides in turn. First, the training data. Well, I'll start with one of the most, I think, infamous cases of ML gone wrong from the summer of 2015, where Google Photos had suggested a caption for a photo album of selfies of two African Americans, and the suggested caption was gorillas. And this turned into an absolute disaster and really had a galvanizing effect within the theoretical computer science community. And you have people like, for example, MIT's Joy Bullamwini doing an intersectional analysis of face classification systems in 2017-2018 and finding that across the board, there were orders of magnitude higher error rates for dark-skinned females in particular compared to other groups. And this work has in turn led to audits of some of the most highly cited academic data sets for face recognition. For instance, Labeled Faces in the Wild, which was found many years after the fact to have, as a result of having been scraped from online newspapers in the late 2000s, it was later found to contain twice as many images of George W. Bush as of all black women combined. Now, these questions of the training data are just as pertinent to domains like autonomous vehicles. We've seen, for example, the Uber car that killed the pedestrian in 2018. And if you read the National Transportation Safety Board review, you discover that apparently there seem to have been no images of jaywalkers in the car's training data. And so when encountered a pedestrian outside of a crosswalk, all bets were off. And furthermore, this was the system was built, as many image classification systems are, with a set of category labels and then examples from each label. So one label was pedestrians, one label was cyclists, and it had been given thousands of examples of each. But when it encountered a woman who was, in this case, walking a bicycle across the street, the classifier didn't know what to do, and all bets were off. To underscore this point, this is Tesla's Andre Karpathy speaking at Berkeley, explaining that as a PhD student, he lost 95% of his sleep thinking about models and algorithms, and today, overseeing autonomous driving at Tesla, he loses 75% of his sleep thinking about data sets. And we've seen the same thing is happening with large language models, where subtle aspects of bias can creep in, or models can learn abusive speech patterns from things that they read online. And we're also seeing it with products like GitHub Copilot, which can incredibly auto-complete code for you based on the comment or the method signature. But there's a funny way in which bugs in the code on which it was trained manifest themselves downstream as bugs in the code that it goes on to write. Now, there's a lot of really exciting work that's being done in things like dataset augmentation, model transparency, debiasing, which we don't have time to explore in detail, unfortunately, but which I think comprise one of the most dynamic areas in ML right now. But the thing that I keep coming back to in particular through all of this work is something close to the so-called Linus's law. Given enough eyeballs, all bugs are shallow. I think that the collection and auditing of these data sets is really a team sport, and it produces something akin to a public good. It is a task that is bigger than what I think any one individual or team could do alone, and I think it's more than what any one individual or team should do alone. I think it's really important that we think about what we in the open source community can do to ensure that the data sets powering the systems that touch our lives are, to the extent possible, open. Open to review, open to critique, and open to pull requests. Okay, let's shift the focus now and look at the objective function. Now, I'd like to begin here with a story about Astro Teller. We know him today as the head of Google X, but in his graduate student days, he was working on a project for the so-called RoboCup to get a group of robots to play soccer. And in particular, he was using reinforcement learning, and he did what many people in reinforcement learning do to give a model sort of a hint that it's in the right direction. He added a little bit of an incentive. So he added a bonus of essentially 1/100th of a goal for taking possession of the soccer ball, because he thought this would kind of steer the learning process in the right direction. Well, what did the system optimize to do? It optimized to approach the soccer ball and then begin vibrating its paddle as quickly as possible, racking up 20 possessions every second. Okay, so incentive failures like this are, I think, familiar to us both in the world of reinforcement learning and also in human incentive structures, as well as in parenting. And there is a very fascinating interdisciplinary literature that's beginning to spring up at the intersection of reinforcement learning, cognitive science, and economics, where the cognitive scientists and the economists are borrowing ideas from the computer science community about how we can detect and fix loopholes in human incentive structures. I think that's really a fascinating collaboration. But the moral, I think, for our purposes, thinking about the machine side, is that it is very hard to create an operational definition of performance success that creates the behavior that we actually want. It's hard in toy domains, and it's even harder the closer you get to situations involving human norms and values. So we'll take one baby step closer to the human norms side of things. So one of the terrific applications of machine learning is colorizing historical photos. And so this is there's a widely used commercial app that you can give it a black and white photo, and it will supply the colorized version of that photo. However, the actual photographs in this particular instance look like this on the bottom. So you can see that the real photographs are way more vibrant, way more colorful, way more interesting than the sort of drab, gray, blah colorizations that the model produces. So what's going on here? Well, my first instinct was that it was probably something in the training data. You know, they had probably trained the model using old photographs that were faded, or the colors had sort of broken down in the film. No, actually, it was something way more interesting than that. It was an issue with the objective function. So this particular model, as is fairly standard, is penalized based on how far away the color that it thinks that particular pixel is in RGB space from the actual color. And so if the actual color is bright red, but you thought it would be bright blue, you get essentially the maximum penalty. And so the model very cleverly, very astutely learns to hedge. And it learns that if you guess these sort of muted earth tone gray colors, you're never too far off. And so, I mean, I think this is another example of how people are starting to think about what is an appropriate loss function for color accuracy, and how can we do something that starts to take into account the sort of psychophysics of color, or just what we actually mean when we think a color is like or unlike another color. So here, in even a seemingly simple task, the full complexity of human psychology sort of comes in. Coming back to the example of GitHub Copilot, why is it that when you submit a slightly buggy prompt, you know, if your comment has some misspelled words in it or the indentation is messed up, then it writes some code for you that's really buggy? Well, what's up with that? Well, this is a direct result of how the model was trained. It was trained on a giant corpus of code in which certain sections were removed, and it would have to guess the missing parts. And so it found that indeed, when you have really sloppy comments, you're likely to have sloppy code, et cetera. And you have bugs, you're likely to have more bugs. But in production, this prediction objective is not what we actually want the system to be doing. In effect, the system is imagining that you have, you yourself have already written the code, and it is trying to guess how you would have written it. And so if you're not very good of a programmer, it will imagine the mediocre way that you specifically would have written that code. That's not actually the objective that we want the system to have. And OpenAI will be the first to acknowledge this. We just haven't quite figured out how to operationalize the objective that we really want. So for now, we use this proxy. But these are problems, and OpenAI is the first to say it, that, as you can see on the graph on the right, the gap gets worse rather than better as the models become more powerful. Bring it back full circle to the infamous gorillas example. We can even think about this as a problem with the objective function as much as it is a problem with the training data. So standard image classification uses what's called a cross-entropy loss. And you can think of this as implying a sort of loss matrix like this, in which every possible misclassification of an X as a Y is equally bad, regardless of X and regardless of Y. But we know this isn't true. In fact, we know that certain errors, certain misclassifications, are in fact probably millions of times worse than others. And so what do we do? Well, a growing number of computer scientists, for example, Stuart Russell at UC Berkeley and many others, are beginning to argue that we should actually treat the loss matrix itself as a set of parameters to be learned. And this, I think, represents one of the most fascinating and, I would say, promising frontiers of AI alignment research. How can we actually treat the objective function itself as something that we want the system to learn? And this brings us to what I think is one of my absolute favorite papers in this space. This comes from a collaboration between OpenAI and DeepMind, who set out to determine if it was possible to teach a virtual robot using reinforcement learning to do a backflip. Now, backflips are a really interesting objective here, because it's impossible for most of us to demonstrate one physically. It's impossible for most of us to perform one on a virtual robot using a game controller. And it's impossible for most of us to describe numerically what the reward function should look like as a function of the torques or the angular momentum or whatever, and get something that looks even semi-reasonable. But we would all know one if we saw one. If we saw a good backflip, it would be very obvious. And so what they had the system do was it would start wiggling around totally at random, and then it would show you a pair of video clips, and it would give you a prompt. The prompt says, look at the clips and select the one in which better things happen. And I love how broad that is. Now, behind the scenes, the system would be doing all of this inference over a class of possible reward functions, saying, in effect, what can I infer about the operational definition of a backflip inside this user's head based on this one bit of information that they preferred clip A to clip B? Okay, it would update its model slightly and show you two more video clips. You'd pick the left one or the right one, and it would show you two more video clips. And after about 900 comparisons, which takes about an hour, it's slightly tedious, something amazing begins to happen, which is that the model begins to perform these gymnastically perfect backflips and stick the landing. And what I think is even more interesting is that different users' backflips actually look a little bit different, as if it is capturing something about the specific platonic ideal backflip in that particular user's head. Now, if we zoom all the way out from the world of machine learning, we start to see the alignment problem, the purpose that we put into the system not being exactly what we really meant or really wanted, as I would argue actually a diagnosis of some of the biggest problems that are facing us in the world. We operationalize education, for example, as good test scores, and we end up teaching to the test. We operationalize a healthy economy as GDP growth, and we end up with the sea level rising. We operationalize social media with time on site, and we get addiction. We operationalize it with engagement, and we get polarization. Alignment research, like the backflip paper, suggests that there might be a way forward out of what I would call the tyranny of metrics, a way to move beyond OKRs and KPIs chosen by hand toward a system that can directly query human preferences and fit the metrics to our values rather than the other way around. Of course, even if we can scale up the idea of reinforcement learning from human preferences, if we can break the tyranny of metrics that permeates not only our software but our institutions, it still leaves us with what is, I think, the oldest ethical question of them all. Who gets to decide? Who gets to say? Whose platonic ideal of a backflip or of healthy community engagement gets implemented? And again, this brings us back to the absolutely essential role that the open source community can play in ensuring that these systems are developed in an inclusive, collaborative, participatory way, and that all stakeholders get a seat at the table. This is a critical moment, I believe. We are simultaneously deploying these systems at scale while at the same time actually discovering what it is that we want and we value, often in real time. There is very real danger there, but very real promise. And I believe it to be the defining challenge of the decade ahead of us. And it's one in which the open source community has a distinct and, I believe, essential role to play. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Certainly thrown down the gauntlet. I love the whole interdisciplinary nature of this kind of work where, you know, originally in open source, it was really just about computer science. I remember at the 20th anniversary of Linux saying, drink up now because AI, ML is going to replace all your coding and we won't even be celebrating the 30th with people. Turns out that was wrong, but the field has become so sophisticated and the idea of this interdiscipline between philosophy and values and machine learning and AI and all this is just incredible. So please, first of all, buy the book. It's a great read. And with that, I want to close the session. We have sessions beginning here at 11:15. We're going to have a happy hour again tonight. Buses will be running back and forth to Napa as well. Enjoy the rest of the day, and we'll see you again here tomorrow. Thank you.